will work for you, protect you, and fight for you, but it doesn't love you. It just wants to watch its shows. In the lead up to the new Murderbot Diaries novel, I look at the Hugo and Nebula winning novella series that started it all. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to SFF 180. Thomas here, your host as always. Thank you for joining me. Martha Wells was very nearly ready to throw in the towel on her writing career when a little book called All Systems Red, running barely 150 pages, suddenly gained massive traction and went on to take home both a Hugo and Nebula Award for Best Novella. For Wells, it was a reversal of fortune story worthy of Horatio Alger. I suppose every fan of the series has their own reason for enjoying it, but I suspect that for most people, it all comes back to Murderbot itself. Yeah, sure, Murderbot is a murderous sec unit and everything, but readers relate to its social anxiety and self-doubt, admire its sense of integrity in seeing a job through with unwavering loyalty, and get a bit of wish fulfillment thrill when it comes time to kick the asses of evildoers. If any SF series has a protagonist who's a one-stop shop, it's Murderbot. Now, I reviewed All Systems Red back when it came out in this video here, so I won't repeat myself. You can watch that in your own time. The original four Murderbot novellas follow a single story arc, pitting Murderbot against the nefarious designs of the Grey Chris Corporation, one of those evil faceless entities that kills anyone who stands in its way. So it would be very easy and even practical to publish them all in a single volume and sell them as a bind-up novel. And frankly, I wouldn't be surprised if it eventually happens. But I will say that publishing these stories as a series of novellas has a lot to do with their artistic success. These books very much reminded me of vintage SF. Now, way back in the day, your average science fiction novel was released in mass market paperback and was pretty short, sometimes coming in at no more than 150 to 200 pages. Now, this length was mandated by editors, especially for mid-list writers, and you could say it was probably a holdover from the days when a lot of new SF novels would first be serialized across 3 to 4 issues of a pulp magazine, which is a practice that analog magazines still does today. So because of this brevity, SF writers from, like, you know, the 1950s to the early 80s had to learn to be lean storytelling machines, getting their business done with economy and skill. And while it may seem limiting by today's standards, it really taught these authors a form of creative discipline that is all too easily lost when you're allowed 860 pages to ramble endlessly. Now, immersing yourself in a mighty tome can be very satisfying, it's true, but there's nothing like the pleasure of a tight, gripping story that you can polish off in a couple of evenings, and the Murderbot Diaries are exactly that. Artificial Condition, which would go on to score the series its second Hugo, picks up right where All Systems Red left off. Now, having skipped out on its previous employer and gone rogue, Murderbot needs to make its way to Ravi Haral, a distant mining world where it hopes to find the truth regarding the mysterious event that led to 57 deaths at its hands. It ends up on an unmanned cargo transport run by an inquisitive and unusually congenial AI, which Murderbot nicknames Art for Asshole Research Transport. Gradually allowing Art to win its trust, Murderbot allows the AI to modify its body so that it can pass at least 2 casual viewers for an augmented human. Then, it accepts a freelance security job in order to gain the necessary clearances to travel to Ravi Haral. Its clients turn out to be 3 callow young scientists looking to retrieve research materials seized by their former employer, Talasi Excavations. Murderbot immediately knows that the meeting is a sham, and that Talasi has every intention of rubbing the scientists out. With Art's help in hacking systems, not to mention its own more practical understanding of the illogic of human behavior, Murderbot now has to keep its clients alive and get them safely off-world while doing its detective work into its own past. The addition of Art as a sidekick adds warmth to a story that feels quite a bit more focused and fleshed out than All Systems Red, as if Wells is really warming up to her new creation. Artificial Condition's view of a distant future run by murderous capitalist tycoons is no less bleak and cynical, but I have to say it is sadly all too realistic. Here we have a future without much of a centralized system of governance over a human spacefaring society, in which corporations acting as nations unto themselves sign workers to decades-long indenture, and treaties are all that keep an uneasy peace. It might have once been possible to believe that employers who think nothing of risking their workers' lives for their own bottom lines were just far-fetched cartoon villains, but as COVID-19 has proved, with companies and even the government demanding low-wage employees go back to work, often without proper safety measures, yeah, these villains are very, very real. Rogue Protocol continues the storyline and amps up the action considerably. Having finally discovered the cause of the massacre on Ravi Haral, Murderbot has decided to further its investigations into the shady practices of Graycris, the megacorp that attacked Murderbot's clients, as well as an additional survey team back in All Systems Red. Graycris, to put it mildly, holds human life cheap. When Murderbot sees a broadcast interview with its former client, Dr. Mensa, discussing an abandoned Graycris terraforming station on the distant world of Milu, and the possibility the whole operation may have been a front for illegally recovering alien artifacts, Murderbot decides to go there itself and investigate on the chance there might be incriminating data to dig up. Milu is not an easy world to get to, but once Murderbot finds passage, it's surprised to discover a couple of human security personnel also traveling to Milu, where they eventually team up with a group of researchers belonging to an independent company looking to reclaim the terraforming station. Murderbot links up with the group's robot, Mickey, who has such a childlike, innocent devotion to its human owners that Murderbot is both fascinated and kind of repelled. The researcher's leader really does treat Mickey like a fully human member of the team, exactly like a beloved family member. And though it's not as if human beings have never been kind to Murderbot, its own deep-seated anxieties and antisocial tendencies have never allowed it to reciprocate that kindness. And certainly not to the degree anyone would think of it as a pet robot. Considering how we are introduced to Mickey, it would have been easy for the character to become just too cloying. After all, when Murderbot first contacts Mickey, she immediately believes Murderbot's transparent cover story with such total trust, you wonder if she's actually a danger to the humans she considers her dearest friends. But Mickey ends up having a remarkable amount of autonomy in her own decision-making. She will become a personal catalyst for Murderbot, her choices influencing the way Murderbot views its own interactions and behaviors towards humans. The story uses its setting, an abandoned station in the dark and stormy upper atmosphere of a hostile alien world, to nerve-wracking effect, as the narrative builds tension leading up to explosive action, all of it contained in a lean and efficient 158 pages. And unlike a lot of stories in similar spooky settings, none of the characters make the kinds of cliched, dumb decisions contrived for no reason other than to put them in danger, a testament to Martha Wells' skill at plot construction. There may be one or two loose ends that will have you scratching your head. Like, it seems like the team abandons one supporting character in a manner that makes you wonder if Wells just forgot about her and the editor didn't notice. But in the end, Rogue Protocol is an adrenaline-pumping adventure that will leave you eager to see Murderbot's quest for justice through to its bitter end. It is perhaps because Rogue Protocol, with its almost perfect balance of action and attention to character, left us with such high expectations that exit strategy, for all its virtues, feels like it comes up a little short. It's still solid entertainment that delivers its own action in spades as it reunites Murderbot with the surviving cast of All Systems Red and propels us towards a final confrontation with the villainous Graycris. But of all the Murderbot novellas, I found it the weakest because it feels as if that confrontation could have been, should have been, explosive. Upon its return from Milu, Murderbot discovers that its involvement in the events of Rogue Protocol have done more harm than good to its former client, Dr. Mensa. With a massive lawsuit pending, Graycris has accused Mensa of sending Murderbot to Milu to, as Murderbot puts it, fuck them over. In addition, Grey Chris has further escalated its response by simply abducting Dr. Mensah away from the station where the suit is being litigated in an effort to get her company to drop the whole affair. What's a murder bot to do other than charge into the rescue? If you're here for fight scenes, you'll be happy. Grey Chris throws everything but the kitchen sink at murder bot, including a nearly invincible combat sec unit, and the action is every bit as propulsive as in Rogue Protocol. But most fans of this series are here for those moments when Murderbot is being all vulnerable and emo. I certainly understand that appeal, especially as Wells has a real talent for extracting the humor out of such moments and giving Murderbot's first bot narration a sardonic edge that never sounds too downbeat to be likable. At the same time, I couldn't help thinking that Murderbot's personal growth has been happening a bit too slowly, and that after four novellas totaling around 600 pages of reading, having the same scenes of somebody being basically kind to Murderbot and Murderbot responding to this by having a massive anxiety attack can start to feel repetitive. It's a lot funnier whenever Murderbot gets endlessly frustrated by humans getting in its way when it's trying to do its job. But by now, Murderbot has not only learned that it wasn't to blame for the events that gave it its ominous nickname, but it has received ample kindness and warmth from the humans it has worked with. Fortunately, we get signs that, by the end of this story, Murderbot may be in a position to make some real changes and move forward at last. If I came away from Exit Strategy disappointed in any part of it, it's that the story arc across all four novellas has always felt like it was building to something bigger and more cathartic in the resolution. Instead, what we're left with is the sense that in this cutthroat future of capitalist criminality run amok, not much is likely to change. As one supporting character says, "We're out of it now. They can tear each other apart." And I kind of felt like I had been promised more than that. Like, I don't know, maybe a couple of buildings crashing to the ground, you know, like the finale of Fight Club. But maybe it's Martha Wells' entire theme here to make the point that in systems where money lets you avoid consequences, systems which are founded on an exploited underclass, that, yeah, not much really changes. Maybe Grey Chris will suffer some consequences for its crimes. Maybe some executives will be forced to resign as a face-saving gesture. But before long, it will be back to business as usual, with more human lives casually tossed into the meat grinder to shore up the bottom line. And thus, more clients for Murderbot to protect. When you think of it that way, perhaps that ongoing anxiety is well-earned. And that's all I have time for on this episode of SFF 180. Next time, I'll be looking at Network Effect, the new full-length Murderbot novel, so we'll see how well it carries the torch. Now remember, the most important thing, these are reviews. You will not always agree with me, but if you enjoyed watching, please slam that like button, share the video far and wide with all of your SFF reading friends, and above all, please subscribe. If you have not yet done so, that is how the channel grows. You can also support the channel at my TeePublic store and at my Patreon, where recruits into Wink's Army get little perks, like getting to see some of my videos early access. I really, really want to thank all those people for their additional support. It is greatly appreciated and very kind. I want to thank all the rest of you guys for being the very best viewers in all of BookTube, and until I see all of you next time, happy reading.